Hello everyone, thanks for coming. So the theme of this talk is improving personalized LiveOps offers and getting the LTV up. And this is going to be about hill climb racing 2, so the case study, couple of approaches and lessons we learned along the way. So I'm head of big data at Superscale, also doing a lot of LiveOps. The company that I work for, practically our motto is that we are trying to form growth partnerships with world top class developers to scale their games to maximum potential. We are doing it not only on LiveOps side, but also on many other fronts. So creatives, UA campaign management, analytics, data science, business intelligence, and also the game design. So there are a couple of partners, a couple of our games that we are working on right now. And we are based in a couple offices around Europe as well. But let's get to the actual talk. So the LiveOps optimization, one of the main points, if I may say, is definitely the business performance. So how can we actually improve the monetization overall? There are many approaches. There are lots of angles. Core game design, better onboarding, economy balancing, so there is no inflation in the game. And what I'm going to focus is LiveOps offers. So I will start with the premise that offers in most games are not maximizing revenue. Most of the time, each player gets either the same price and content in an offer or gets to choose from 3 to 5 similar offers. There is no consideration of player's payment potential, his spending habits, his in-game behavior, and in the end, this leads to lower satisfaction from the purchasing, lower conversion, and well, this is a missed opportunity and lower revenue. Now, the question is, how can we actually improve the performance by utilizing the existing content in a game and doing it in a way that we don't actually impact the existing monetization systems? And I believe that the answer to that question is that we are delivering relevant content at relevant time for a relevant price. And how can we do it? Well, by utilizing segmentation, targeting players on a personal level. Now, for a little sneak peek, these are our results from Hill Climb Racing 2. So in the end, we managed to bring 52% LTV uplift from baseline by utilizing what I just mentioned on the last slide. I will be returning to this slide at the end. Pretty much on the chart, in orange is the baseline. In red, our Fingersoft seasonal offers. So the baseline are game purchases. Those are rank up purchases, rank up offers, seasonal and legendary offers for players that are later in the game. And there is, in blue, of course, our offers. So the approach, so where did we start? So segmentation as a thing has been in the business for a little while. So the base model for LiveOps is something called STP, which stands for segmentation, targeting, and positioning. The STP model describes the process in 4 questions: who, what, how much, and how often. So how can we actually position some product on the market? One application of this system is something that you've probably all heard about, and is the LTV-based segmentation when we are talking about whales, dolphins, minnows. And this is a good start. It's easy to understand. It's most widely used, and it enables basic targeting. Well, it's not the best one. One better approach is utilizing RFM. So RFM stands for recency, frequency, and monetary value. Again, this is something that has been used for decades. It directly models purchasing behavior, this in terms of actual purchasing. So it's great for predicting purchase effectiveness. It's as well easy to understand and apply in content creation process. And it's basis for targeted offers that we are using. But it still doesn't provide no answer to what we are actually offering to the player. And this comes from something that we call gameplay interaction segmentation. So as all of you know, players in the game are not the same. They unlock different content, progress to different points in the story. They have different split between game modes and different spending habits after all. And the best results, what we've seen so far, is actually coming from the combination of both segmentation approaches, and this is what I'm going to be talking in the case study. So now for a little intro for the Hill Climb Racing 2 game. It's a multiplayer racing game developed by Fingersoft, Finnish studio from Oulu, released late 2016. Actually, we were helping with the soft launch and global launch as well for both platforms. Over the time, accumulated more than 150 million players. And the case study is practically about how we delivered the uplift. Couple screenshots from the game, so you have some idea. This is pretty much the gameplay is gas pedal and brake pedal, and you are trying practically to get to the finish line the first. you are competing against other players in asynchronous multiplayer way, so pretty much a competitive game. There are some metagame systems, so obviously card collection. You can upgrade cards for the soft currency, and there is also one additional part. You are able to acquire gacha tuning parts that can make your car even better. So, for example, wings let you fly longer after a big jump. And this is one part that we are actually focusing on selling the most because, well, as you probably know, the gacha is just something that usually works very good in free-to-play games. So for a short overview of how the pre-personalization monetization Hillcam Racing 2 actually looked like, so it was pretty solid actually at the time. So we had direct game pack purchases, rank-based offers on the left, tied to progression, special offers that were rotating constantly through the shop in the basically offered skin, good value, incentivized by games, and seasonal offers, which you can see on the right, for example, through Oktoberfest, and for special events like when kids are going back to school, for Christmas, Easter, and so on. So, like, first, for summary of our goals, of course, it was to increase the revenue through personalization, as I said, deliver the right content, right time, for the right price, while not harming user retention, and while minimizing cannibalization of future profits. And cannibalization will be the last big part that I'm going to be talking about. So in a way, we are looking at this as an optimization problem. So we are trying to increase revenue per user while minimizing additional value, but not value in the major sense, but in terms of value multiplier. Because in the end, if you are offering player just too much value, he has less incentive to buy again. And we believe that the actual value is in the personalization, in giving the players the best thing that he can get for the right price that is correct for him. And we can do it by optimizing several parameters of the offer. So the price, what is the actual content, what is the value, availability, what is the offer succession, for example, etc. So this for a little like peek on our infrastructure, very high level. The important part is on the left. This is the business analytics part. This is where the logic actually happens. So we always start with understanding of players, how they react, what is their purchasing behavior, etc. So this is BI analysis. When we learn about what players are actually doing, we can push the features, the design to machine learning models that output the offers, offer configs, and user pairings that we are then using. So on the right side, in yellow and in green, this is basically distribution service. So in the end, the client requests what is my offer at this time, and the server delivers it to him, and it gets displayed. We get the data for the offer impression. We get the data for in a purchase. It goes back to our systems, and we can evaluate the results and start again. So this is kind of like high-level structure. Now, for this slide, I'm not going to go into much detail. In the end, there are lots of modules. You need to have A/B testing tools. You need to have some sort of evaluation. You need to basically think about how you are going to do this long-term. The important part for us, of course, is the profiling of players. So on the left, we are taking into account a lot of lots of attributes in terms of purchasing behavior, currency spending, tuning parts usage, vehicle progression. There are those that are more important. There are those that will just never make major change. But in the end, this is what goes into the models, and this is what we are using at the moment. So this is one example of a player progression of a players that actually we have a couple of those in the game, and one challenge when describing the segments is that players are very unique in how they approach the game. So this is a player that purchased a vehicle with his soft currency. He then spent all of his currency on upgrading of this vehicle, and he joined an event. And in the event, he got beaten by other players that are using other car, different car. For the event, he got a rare part for the car that he just got beaten with, and he ends up buying the bundle with the car, with the skin, and he makes the first conversion. So the question is, can we find these patterns? Can we learn from our existing data and utilize it for targeting of similar players in the future? So this is pretty much the last part of the talk. I will be going through four challenges and pretty much which describe all the process that we are actually doing. So we are starting with understanding of player behavior. So what are the players' needs, preferences at the moment? What is their payment potential? How can we react in timely manner to their changing needs over time? Like for example, shifting between focus on different game modes, etc. Then we are talking about creation of offers, how to keep things fresh and rotate to similar offers over and over again, because in the end, this is not about just doing it once per month. We are aiming to do multiple offer sets per week. Then, of course, evaluation, A/B testing, and continuous improvement. Not aiming for one big bump on once or twice per month, but going for the something that is long-term sustainable. And the last part, very important one: how can we actually avoid the cannibalization of future profit? So ties to the question of how much additional value players should actually get. So let's talk about the first one. So this was our first personalization model. We already brought 40% improvement over the baseline during Go for Weekends. We knew that we could do better. The basis was RFM, where we took into account recency, so how recent was the last purchase, the LTV, and the average purchase of the previous purchases. And from the behavior, we used only two major features: most played and most upgraded vehicle. Well, we knew that we could do better, we kind of like found that actually after analyzing the data, the good performance was achieved by using, when we looked at the highest previous purchase. So we've introduced that. And in terms of behavior, we found, this is from one data science model, again, not enough time here to go through it all, but the black areas, these kind of like segmentation of where players are actually spending their money on which type of basically in-app types, so like offers or games, and those black areas practically meant that this segment of players didn't purchase at this kind of in-app type at any point in time. So there was a segment of players who, for example, had a very high LTV, but they didn't buy a single offer, even though the offers had much higher value than just for just straight games, but they were kept buying games. So this was like a learning point for us that, all right, maybe we need to go with the personalization deeper and actually introduce even basically the currency heavy offers. Let's say we are focusing at gacha at the moment. And regarding the prediction of chess type, when we were trying to introduce data science model, this is kind of like anecdote. You would like to have some good proper training set, but there was no training set because we didn't have personalized offers before. So what we tried to do was predict the purchase of a legendary chest in shop. So legendary chest in shop is something that costs between $10 to $20, and the legendary vehicle chest is something that rotates through different vehicles through different days, and you can buy it pretty much directly for games. So we said, okay, let's see what is the event sequence that leads to this purchase. And this was during last year. What we found out that for the last 30 days of when we were actually analyzing it, we found that 20% of players who bought the pretty expensive vehicle chest, they didn't have the car yet. So they bought it for something they didn't own yet, and automatically all the features that we generated for the like predicting that took into account the engagement with the vehicle were just not usable. So by default, our predicting effectiveness would go to 80%, and it was the best we could do with that set of attributes. So it's in the end it's tricky, and again, one learning: players are not behaving necessarily rationally in the games, well, as you probably already know. And this is our current data science model. So this is what actually brought the uplift. So not again, RFM, already talked about that. One more addition, probability modeling. It's kind of like a waterfall system where we try to understand what is the best price point for the user to have, considering his previous, and what is the succession of price points that might convert him. And the best model to use for the content definition, that would be actually the extreme gradient boosting, because it can take a huge amount of features. And now we are using actually a number of features is in hundreds. We never could do that by hand. The manual analysis has some limits. So a couple takeaways, LTV and frequency of purchasing are more important than recency. We tested multiple times, and especially if you would like to start with something, I would recommend to starting with looking at the previous highest purchase. So this would be something that I would use to base the pricing tiers of offers on. And in terms of behavior, finding a way how to practically offer user something that he interacts the most with without breaking the existing systems would be something that would be good starting point as well. The issue in gacha-based games, for example, is of course you can find easily what is the most used content, but you cannot just offer it directly because you would then break all the other gacha. So it's a tricky topic. It differs game to game, but if you can find something that ties to the most used content, actually, like that was the biggest bump that we've practically seen in the performance. Now for the creation offers and how to keep things fresh. There are a couple of elements of offers to optimize that I was mentioning before. So of course there's the content. Are you using resources or not? Are you personalizing all the stuff in the offer or not? There's the visuals and copy, availability, offer price, and additional value. Now this is something that in the end is your job. You can have the best model that you can create, and it still won't tell you exactly what you are actually should offer to the user. So how much of the different stuff. I will jump straight to takeaways here. One thing that we've seen work very well was changing the theme of the offer more frequently. So basically one offer is focused on gacha, so the second is focused on currencies. There should be a variety of offered items to basically keep the offers from feeling stale. So on the pictures, there are offers from the single iteration. So as you can see on the left, there is offer one vehicle chest and incentivized by coins. On the right side, there is one vehicle chest but of high rarity and incentivized also for gems. This is from the same iteration, they also have different background. What we found out was that probably this user on the right responded well to a game purchases before, or he's liking just the amount of games that you are looking at. Now, while the player on the right, on the left, probably has some games already stacked, or he's missing again the soft currency in a big way. And the user in the middle, well, we are using just gacha for this user. So for the evaluation, A/B testing and continuous improvement. So as I said, we are aiming for a long-term improvement. We don't want to call it day after two, three successes. So in terms of A/B testing, there are infinite amount of things that you can A/B test. The important part is to focus on, well, the ones that can really make the difference. So for us, one big one is pricing. So at the moment in time when we started doing offers, there was actually the offers weren't priced very very heavily. Most of the offers were priced at $20 and up to $40, and the only more expensive thing were game packs. So we actually didn't know how players would react to offers that were costing like $80, and we just wanted to be sure. So we A/B tested for the top segment. 50% of players got $80, for the other one got $50. What we've seen, well, the players reacted positively, and while the conversion went down, in the end it's about the revenue per user. The RPPU offsetted the lower conversion, and LTV went up by 46% for this segment. Then the better you do the better you do the personalization, of course, the better the overall results are. But the reason is that you can actually get to offer players lower value multiplier. And again, what we've seen is by using better and better models, we are able to, well, with not increasing the frequency of the offers, we are able to keep pretty much the same performance as we did. And for example, for top segments, the overall additional value that we are giving is sometimes as low as like 12%. So pretty much it's almost the same that players would be able to buy for games, but it's personalized, it's in unique combination, it's bundled in a way that he would never see it in the shop in other parts. And for example, for segment definition, There is a waterfall model testing. So one thing that we see a lot of developers struggle is even if you develop some kind of segmentation, usually it's static. If you have a rule-based algorithm, adding something that can move players between segments is a tough thing to do because in the end you have to weight someone, somehow how important the last impression than the fact that players didn't interact with the offer, how important it actually is. And again, this is a good candidate for A/B testing. And of course, players change, players' behavior change, your game changes. So should we still focus on the most played vehicle, or should we focus on the most played vehicle in the contents of in which game modes they are using it? Well, this is for the A/B testing, and there is one other part that we try to do practically at all times. As I said, it's about monitoring performance over time in the middle. We are also monitoring community. So most probably your players are active somewhere, or they are discussing stuff. Maybe it's Reddit, maybe it's Facebook groups, maybe it's Discord. So we are looking at how players are reacting to offers actually here as well. It's very uplifting to see that we are pretty like, we are not completely sure how players would react to expensive offers that didn't give players as much value as they are probably used to see in other games, and they reacted positively because they got unique combination of vehicles. They've like exotic vehicles that they just would never get otherwise. And of course, the cannibalization can develop over time, and by the things that you are introducing, you also need to look at it on the like the most easiest to understand would be the price point level. And the idea is we don't want to negatively affect any aspect of the game. So a few takeaways here. So the important thing to ask when doing A/B tests and practically asking almost any question from data, and this goes beyond gaming, is to ask the right questions from the data. So if the answer doesn't change what you would do, the question is probably not that important, and you should ask a different question that would actually affect what you are doing. A/B tests are expensive, so you should test for major things first. On your segmentation method is more important than testing of a new background, and if you can afford to only do few, you should focus on the ones that you think that could make or break the existing models. And your community is probably active somewhere. Try to find those players and see how they perceive offers they are getting. And now for the last part of this talk, avoiding cannibalization. So how much additional value players should get? Well, the first question, and we haven't talked about it much yet, is these are our results. So in the end, it was plus 41% of total revenue growth over more than 33 iterations now. As I said, orange baseline, red seasonal offers, and blue personalized offers. But the question is, how much have we actually impacted the baseline? So is there some cannibalization? How much? Well, to calculate this, we've kind of like brainstorm, we realized that there's just no other way than do a proper A/B testing. When we are looking at LTV uplift, we are taking into account the LTV uplift, the true LTV uplift. We are taking into consideration basically deducting the baseline cannibalization that we are doing. And to calculate it, we need a control group, we need to run a long-term A/B test. So before every iteration, we split new payers that basically were active from the last iteration in the game on 90 to 10. 10% of players go into the control group, 90% of players start getting personalized offers. And we do the same for non-payers. Of course, non-payers and payers are two very different groups of payers, players. Non-payers, of course, don't have any RFM segment. They don't have any purchasing, so we are doing only behavioral segmentation. And pretty much this is how the evaluation can look like. This is for the payer group. So what do you see on the chart in green? The top line is the cumulative LTV calculated as cumulative revenue divided by cumulative number of distinct players. This and on x-axis are dates. And pretty much this is the LTV curve. When you see the blue line, it's the same group but with offers deducted. Now, this means that our offers generated 84% LTV uplift, but there is the control group in red, and this is what we would generate actually, or around this line, if there would be no personalized offers and players would just receive what they would usually receive. And that leaves us with 21% baseline cannibalization, which leads to actually us able to compute the true uplift, which is at 49%. Now, this is a bit different for non-payers, practically new players that come to the game, where we see that the uplift is even higher. And while there was a cannibalization for payers, there is none in for non-payers. So similarly here, the top line is non-payers with segmented offers. Pink is non-payers without, after deduction. And it's still the line, the baseline basically increased over time, and the orange in control is still under it. So the hypothesis is that personalized offers can actually increase the engagement of players over time, and we've actually confirmed this by looking at the spending behavior, their engagement overall after the purchase, and pretty much the personalized offers at the start led to higher satisfaction and higher wish to repurchase again in the future. Now for a couple of the takeaways from the last part, this is the last slide of the presentation. The cannibalization is not something you can ignore. We've seen multiple developers introduce special offers in the way that they were offering just copious amounts of additional value without properly testing it. So if you can test it properly through A/B testing, through long-term control groups. The second one, offering hard currency in offers is something that is very tricky. It can introduce huge cannibalization of the existing monetization systems. In our case, we've had a couple of offers that we were trying to play with this, and players reacted positively. But what we've seen was they practically, the game purchases went down by 50% of these subsegments, and there was a huge learning point for us. You just need to do it carefully or drop it altogether, because it's just so tricky to do. So incentivization with games is something that you should be careful about, and making players happy with their first purchase, again, something that maybe we would expect, might cause zero cannibalization and even lead to increased LTV further down the line. And that was it. Thank you for your attention. And
but I got questions for you. So more or less, so how many segments do you have for a typical game?
Okay, so our first iterations, we focused on four price points, and for each price point, in Hilltown Racing 2 specifically, we are looking at vehicles. So there were 17 vehicles, so 4 times 17. So that was our starting point. In the end, we found out that the more extreme personalization in Hilltown Racing 2 is kind of like a good example, because they have just so many payers and players overall. In one iteration, we did 20,000 different segments, but these segments were not really 20, segments.
20,000?
20,000, but this was 20,000 different offers, because what we actually did for the first time was getting free vehicles that players played most of the time based on some parameter optimization, and players were able to get legendary chests for a Moonlander, epic chests for a bus, and rare chests for a scooter, which is very weird combination, and this would be something that you would never think of in terms of how would you actually create the system in rule based, but it was something that players reacted super positively to. So in the end, there is some limitations, of course, you cannot then look at performance of specific vehicles, but it can range at from anything 40 to 100 usually, just so it's easier to work with and you actually understand what you are evaluating, I would say.
And when super scale comes in place, is it at the start of a game, in the middle of the game? So when do you start to put the magic in?
So these kind of LiveOps systems, of course, they would be valuable even during soft launch. At the moment when you are starting to look at monetization, this is practically when this is relevant. At the same time, for the game to grow, you just need some mass of players, and if you are acquiring 100 users during soft launch just to test high level of KPIs, it might just not be good enough mass. So I would say global launch definitely, and depending on the soft launch scale, maybe even then.
Good. So, you know, so there's no right time to start except at the start.
Yeah, and of course, this is kind of like cream on the top. Like the base monetization has to work for this to work. Like because otherwise you don't have anything to offer. So I would definitely not focus on segmentation, LiveOps optimization until the monetization is at least in okay state.
Okay, that's very good to know. Thank you so much. That was. Yeah.